bit about your character, because that was also a very interesting character. I mean, she would seem like she was hiding a lot, as we eventually saw. But it seemed like that there were different sort of stories going on with your co-stars in the anarchist group. You could just talk about like the development of that, of those different relationships, and how much was discussed in rehearsing the character and kind of building the story with each of the characters.
Yeah, I mean, we didn't necessarily discuss or rehearse that much. I mean, I think what was, you know, wonderful about making this movie, and really a testament to Brit and Zal, is a group of people came together because they just so absolutely believed in the project. And you really, really felt that. Because you can't meet Zal and Brit and have a conversation with them and not be just completely blown away by their intelligence, their kindness, their intent for telling stories, you know, their creative purpose, and you just, it's infectious, and you just absolutely want to be involved, and you really felt that with the whole cast and the crew even. So there was just immediately this absolute organic sense of connection, like nothing felt forced, and I feel like I see it in the film. So I feel like all of us had our sort of different friendships and would spend time together in Shreveport, and it created something, I think, that was just very natural that you see. And in regards to Izzy, I mean, as an actor, it was just absolutely a thrill to play. I mean, this woman who's incredibly passionate and angry and frustrated, that I think, at things that a lot of people are right now, and decides to take accountability for her own life and get eye for an eye justice for those she believes have committed atrocities, and continue to exploit the world and those who are the most disenfranchised. And then, of course, it's a testament to Britain's old script, the fact that her journey is so profoundly emotional. So sort of despite what you feel of all the external goings on, you know, one would hope that that could be a way for the story to hopefully enter the audience, because obviously her personal anguish with her father and et cetera is, to me, fascinating and to me, makes the story.
Sal, if you could talk a little bit more about creating the story, because one of the things I really liked about it was that it seemed like everything in the movie, in the story, were like true events, like things that we've seen in the news, things that had happened. It didn't feel like anything was made up, and if you talk about like sort of taking real events and then sort of constructing a fiction around it, which that felt like it was a, you know, a really great thriller.
Great, yeah. So Brit, who plays Sarah, and I, we wrote the film together, and we spent a summer in 2009 traveling, and we were very curious to know, we lived in LA, and we were very curious to know how other young people were constructing meaningful lives for themselves. And Brit wanted to be an actress, and I wanted to be a director, and those are not easy jobs to get. And so we had learned to write, you know, taught ourselves to write. We'd written a script we really liked called Sound of My Voice, but we couldn't get it financed. And so in those frustrations of all that rejection and that sort of uncertainty, we took to the road, and we were fascinated by freegan lifestyle, which is free, and so that's very convenient when you're out of money. And we were actually blown away by what we encountered, whether we were in a sort of, we came across abandoned houses in the middle of the inner city, or there was a farm on the outskirts of a once very prosperous American city. There was a farm that this group of people had built out of these sort of abandoned lots. And so out of the concrete came this like tomato vine. And I remember being really struck by all that. And in each place that we went, we encountered all this tribal living, where other young people were working together to sort of eke out an existence. And so Brit and I took something from that summer, which was that there was this free, abundant natural resource available to us back at home in LA. And that was other young people who wanted to do the same thing we wanted to do, which was to make movies. And so we sort of harnessed that, and we stopped asking for permission, and we started just doing it. And that's how we made Sound of My Voice. We made Sound of My Voice 3 or 4 months later. And then the experience was so kind of intense for us, the experience of being on the road, that we took the sort of freedom we experienced on the road and grafted it to the anxieties we were experiencing just looking, you were talking about being a news junkie, the anxieties we experienced just reading the news. So all the news, all the corporate crimes in the East are all based on 100% of fact. So the pharmaceutical that causes those side effects actually exists. That pharmaceutical makes $1.4 billion a year. And to some people, it has those devastating side effects. And then, you know, oil spills, of course, are real. And we actually wrote the oil spill scene in the movie before the BP oil spill. So when the BP oil spill happened, we felt this fire under our asses to keep writing. And so that's how we sort of came to make the movie.
Well, let's